Hello all, and welcome to today's SANS webcast. We are just having a little technical difficulty with AJ joining. He should be here momentarily, so hang tight and we will be with you shortly. We're getting closer. AJ is almost with us. Please hang tight and we will get started in just a few minutes. Thank you. Right, AJ, we have you here now.
I am here, and I'm so sorry for everyone that was here and ready, and I wasn't. But we're gonna get going here in a second. Thank you so much, Laura, for holding it down.
You betcha, and you should be able to share your screen now.
All right, outstanding, and then everyone can see my face, and I'll get my screen up here shortly. I did just log into my VM, and it appears I'm having some issues which is, you know, par for the course when you're trying to do a live demo. So if we do run into issues, I will freestyle and we'll figure this out. But we're going to go ahead and go for it.
Perfect. And let me just start by saying, anyone who has questions for AJ during the presentation, please put them in the Q&A feature and we will address them either as we go or at the end if we're running along. And you do get CPE credit for this, and you would just log into your SANS portal account to get that. And there will be a recording of this available afterwards as well. So welcome, and AJ, it's yours.
Thanks so much, Laura. Again, appreciate you holding it down as I was a little late here. So thanks everyone that's here attending or watching the recording. Really excited to chat with you today in part three of our three-part series. Now, it does look like my virtual machine is acting up. So we're going to get through these slides. I'm going to show you a few other things that are going to be useful. But what I promise I'll do, and I've done it before, is we'll do a demo follow-up video that you'll all get via email when I get this virtual, when we get the recording sent out afterwards, and we'll upload a video of the demo on YouTube. So to get started, again, this is a three-part series to bring attention to the SEC 557 Continuous Automation for Enterprise and Cloud Compliance course. And today we're going to talk specifically about Cloud Query and how compliance professionals can utilize this tool to achieve your compliance goals in the cloud and reduce management uncertainty when you're making decisions. So this is the final series. I'm extremely excited about it. Before we get started, I'll tell you all a little bit about myself. I'm the co-founder and CEO of ByteCheck. We are a cybersecurity compliance automation startup, and our slogan is to make compliance suck less. And we built a SaaS platform designed to automate compliance assessments for startups and small businesses by integrating directly with cloud providers like AWS, Azure, GCP, and other apps like GitHub, Jira, and Bitbucket. I sit on a few professional boards. I've earned a few certifications, served for 6 years in the Army as a signal officer, both here in the States and overseas deployed. And lastly, I am currently the SANS Associate Instructor for Sec 557. So hopefully I see any of you out there. And speaking of SANS courses, before we get started, I do want to make sure you're all aware of the many SANS courses that we have underneath the cloud security pillar. There's lots of really good classes that are relevant to modern cloud environments. And I think this is the struggle and the hard part about learning about technology or just the cloud in general nowadays, is making sure that you're getting content that's going to be relevant to your organization, that's going to be relevant to the modern world. And this, the cloud security curriculum at SANS is doing that. We have essentials of cloud security to a DevSecOps course, cloud forensics, and many more. The course that I serve as an associate instructor for, Sec 557, falls under the cloud security curriculum. And we talk all about cloud and DevOps and how to measure security and compliance. It's a really fun course, a lot of demos. Definitely encourage you to check these out at sans.org/cloud security. So just to recap the series, we started out talking theoretically about why you need automation to achieve compliance in the cloud. And I just saw one of the comments here in the chat, and we definitely will be able to provide links to those first two sessions. Thank you, Lara, for providing those. Because I do encourage you, if you're watching this one, some of the things that we would talk about when it comes to cloud query, it'd be very beneficial for you to have watched the OS query webinar before this, that from a couple of weeks ago, and even the first one that really talks about the theoretical why we need automation to achieve compliance in the cloud. There are blog posts to supplement those first two series as well that go with the webcast that includes some screenshots of the demos that we did and some of the scripts that we were running. And there will be a blog post to follow up this cloud query one as well. So in that first one, we talked about the philosophy we follow in Sec 557 and how compliance professionals should live off the land when performing compliance assessments. We'll talk about what living off the land means a little bit later. We also went into a demo of PowerShell and how we can use its power of its object-oriented language and cross-platform ability to automate compliance measurements. So that was our first demo there in that first one. We did some demos of PowerShell, both on our local machines as well as some stuff from AWS. In part two, we dove into OS query, and we'll revisit some of those concepts today. And today we're going to look at cloud query, which is a really cool tool that can help you prove multi-cloud and multi-account compliance. So we're going to take a quick look at our agenda, and we're going to do a quick review of OS query because cloud query and OS query go hand in hand. But again, encourage you to take a look at those links that Laura just dropped there in the webcast from a few weeks ago, because that's going to definitely help you understand some of these concepts that we kind of go through pretty fast here at the beginning of this webinar. Then we're going to dive directly into what cloud query is, some of those use cases. We'll specifically talk about compliance there. And Cloud Query Hub is a relatively new tool, but since the virtual machine looks like it's not working, we'll spend some time in Cloud Query Hub talking through some of these concepts and the type of information that you'll get. And last, so we would have finished up with the demo here, but what I'm going to do is make sure that I record a demo later on when I figure out what's going on with my machine. And Laura will send that out to all of you that have registered. All right. So now that we got rid of all of the initial stuff, let's go ahead and get into the talk. A quick reminder about OS query. It's an open source endpoint package developed by Facebook. Think just an agent that you would install on your machine that allows you to expose system info as a relational database. So it's a really great way to be able to go and get OS information and be able to interact with it, visualize it as a relational database. It's cross-platform and cross-virtualization, which is why I really, really like the tool. because it's impossible nowadays to find a company that you're evaluating that is all Windows or all Linux. You're going to see a mix of operating systems, a mix of virtualization. So using tools like OS Query and Cloud Query that can go across these different providers is really key. Last I checked, there were over 275 tables currently in the project. It is open source, so it changes almost by the day. When we first put together SEC557 and went through the beta run of it earlier this year, there were about 250 tables. When I did the webcast a couple weeks ago, there was 275. So you can see there's already 25 additional tables just this year. About 50 of those tables work across platforms. So what does that mean? That means I can run the same OS query on what's called like a users table. If I want to get some critical information about users on my system, I can run the same exact query on a Windows box that I can run on a Mac OS and that I can run on a Linux box, which makes your life super easy as a compliance professional. Now, these design principles are important to understand, especially that last one regarding the flexible universal language of SQL. Now, I'm sure there's some compliance professionals watching this and you're like, I have no clue how to write a SQL statement, AJ. I'm not a database administrator. I don't want to be a database administrator. Why are you telling me that this is a good thing? Trust me, you can do it. SQL is not that hard to learn. You don't necessarily have to become a database administrator to use OS Query. It's really simple to put together a few statements and we'll see if we can mess around with this with this box here to see if we can get connected and show you some of these things. But when with this language, we can use the power of SQL where we can join certain tables together. We can grab specific information out of tables and do a bunch of things to get that information directly from our cloud infrastructure and providers. So that's a really powerful aspect of OS Query that we're going to be able to leverage when it comes to Cloud Query as well. There's really two ways that you can use OS Query. OS Query I is how we were going to demonstrate Cloud Query today, which is you run it at the console in the command line, and you basically run commands locally there. Incident responders typically use OS Query I frequently to be able to get information about an attack or potential incident in an ad hoc manner. Think if your incident responder really just wants to know, okay, we know there was an attack. Let me just find out what's going on. Let me check some of our files. They're going to do that in kind of a one-off manner. Those are going to be what you call local queries. And you can do this for compliance checks. You also see it for forensic and threat hunting. Like I said, we're going to show you the OS query or the cloud query settings in a similar setup there for cloud query using OS Query I. OS Query D or Daemon is the service or application that allows you to run remote requests against the system. This is where you're going to really get into automating compliance, right? This is where you have a daemon on your box. You can schedule queries to run at a set time. In the OS Query space, those are going to be called some query packs where you can basically say, I have the set of 10 queries that are going to check database encryption, that are going to check this check, they're going to check MFA, et cetera. And we're going to put all these into one essential big script, and it's going to run on a regular basis. You can do the same thing with Cloud Query using this daemon and service as well. So this is a way that you can have a single query run across multiple machines, which allows for very fast and efficient data gathering. As I mentioned today, we're going to run Cloud Query queries using OS Query I, if I can do some live troubleshooting here. We'll dive into showing you the power of using that SQLite engine that OS Query is powered by. All the parsing, optimization, and execution functionality from SQL you're going to be able to do here directly in Cloud Query. All right, so now that you all are OS Query experts and we're all caught up on OS Query, let's get into Cloud Query. So Cloud Query is an open source project that allows you to query your cloud assets and configuration with SQL, like I mentioned. Similar to how OS Query is going to extract the metadata from your operating system, your Macs, your Linux, or your Windows boxes, Cloud Query is going to extract configuration and metadata of your cloud infrastructure and transform it into a relational SQL database. that configuration and metadata of your infrastructure, you're able to see it in the database, interact with it. You can write queries for easy monitoring, governance, and security. And the cool thing is, because it's using that SQLite engine, we can really get specific information from tables. Now I'll give you an example here, just in case we can't talk about it or demonstrate it later. Certain tables contain a lot of data that just might not be relevant to what you're looking for as it relates to a specific check or control test. As an example, the AWS IAM users table, it contains over 20 columns. So you imagine trying to get a specific piece about a password policy or a thing about a user in that, and you have 100 of users and there's 20 columns to look through. Maybe you don't want to see all of that. Maybe you just want to know, what account are they in? What's the last time they used their password, and is MFA enabled? And that's all you want to know. You can get that specific piece of information out because of the SQL underlying nature there of Cloud Query. Now, some of the key features of Cloud Query include, of course, just to start with SQL, is exploring and monitoring that. That ETL process that Cloud Query does to get the data, it's generally scattered across different cloud and SaaS providers, different APIs, but Cloud Query puts it into a local PostgreSQL data relational database that gives you the ability to focus on your business logic without writing code and without working directly with APIs. You get to abstract all of that directly on your machine and make your life easier as a compliance professional, because one, you're no longer having to go log into Azure, log into AWS, log into GCP. To get all of this information, you're able to get it from one place using Cloud Query. And the cool thing about Cloud Query being an extension of OS Query, chances are your administrators have OS Query installed on their machines. So when we talk about living off the land and we talk about being able to use the tools that your administrators use, this is a tool that you can go directly to your administrators and say, hey, I need to get all of this information from our cloud providers. Here's a query that you can run against Azure, GCP, and AWS to get said information, making your life really easier, making their lives easier. That's one of the underrated aspects of compliance, is we really need to make sure that we're making the other people in our organization's lives easier as they're going through these compliance assessments. No one likes compliance. No one wants to deal with this stuff. So when you make people jump through hoops or grab screenshots when you could get that information automatically, it causes tension. Over the past few months, I think it has been, I've participated in a few speaking engagements with my friends over at Chef Software, including an upcoming talk that we'll be doing at the virtual Chef Conf next month. And a lot of these sessions, we've talked about how there's often a different language spoken between operations, security, and compliance professionals. And I think that's truly the problem with compliance, is most compliance professionals are not speaking the same language as their security and operations teams. They're not speaking the same language as the engineers. So that different language causes confusion and inefficiencies. And that's the reason why you'll see that tension. That's the reason why compliance is looked down upon, because it's seen as a blocker. It's seen as something that's going to cause issues with operations or slow people down because you're asking for manual pieces of evidence, when those administrators and security professionals probably know there's a better way to get more technical information, but they don't want to spend the time explaining their language to the auditor. And I think a tool like Cloud Query helps you bridge that gap. Because we're writing this in SQL, most of those individuals can read it and understand it. It's a common language that anyone can understand really by reading what we're getting, regardless of your experience with it. So now you can write your security and compliance rules using SQL. So the same way the operators and the engineers are using infrastructure as code to build, change, and version infrastructure, we can use Cloud Query and Cloud Query policies to monitor, alert, and version our cloud infrastructure security and compliance rules. So really powerful. If you think about the shift in the space from a DevOps to moving to more DevSecOps, you're constantly hearing about security shifting left, but we never really hear about compliance shifting left, right? It feels like compliance is being left out of that conversation. And I think the reason is because we're speaking a different language. So those individuals just don't necessarily think we can understand and speak the same language that they're speaking, but this gives us a way to do this. And that's the concept that we talk a lot about in the course about living off the land. And we'll get into that on the next slide. The last real huge feature of CloudQuery is that it's open source and it's an extensible framework. So it's always growing. You can always add to it. We'll take a look at CloudQuery Hub to see some of the tables that currently exist, some of the providers that exist. When I first started messing with CloudQuery, I was really focused on the cloud providers, but I just saw that they have now some additional features where you can run queries against Kubernetes clusters. You can run queries against your Okta instance as well. So they're moving into identity, they're moving into containers. And I really like that because you're not gonna see all of the same stuff, one only AWS in an organization. You're gonna see, you know, they're gonna be hosted on AWS, maybe have some resources in Azure. Maybe have on both of those, they're using Kubernetes to run their containers. And then, by the way, identity is done through Okta. So instead of having to figure out how do I get all this information from all of these different places, you can now just say, I'm going to run these queries. I'm going to create these policies. I'm going to run these queries to get the information I need. And it's going to be a language that my engineers understand and that my operators understand. So let's talk a little bit about why CloudQuery for compliance. If you remember, for anybody that's here that watched part one and part two, you'll remember that we talked about the need for auditors to live off the land. And I mentioned it a few times here today about living off the land. And that means that you use the tools that your administrators are using, and then you let them administer them. This makes your life easier. This makes their life easier. So now you can say, here you go. Here is this script to run. And when you run it, it's going to generate a report for me. And all those compliance checks and conversations that we used to have, we no longer have to have because I'm getting the information I need on a regular basis. And doing this ensures that you're not interfering with or disrupting operations. Now, obviously, one of the benefits of CloudQuery is the fact that you can run it across multiple cloud providers. However, I do have my opinions on multi-cloud setups. I personally have not heard a good justification for running multi-cloud. You generally can get the same benefits within one cloud provider, which puts less stress and pressure on your team to monitor and manage multiple cloud providers. I'm one of those individuals that yes, technology is important, but I'm always going to defer to how does this impact individuals? And I think multi-cloud setups negatively impact the people that are responsible for managing that, because now they have to be an expert on both AWS and Azure, or AWS and GCP, whatever those different cloud providers may be. And I think that whatever your goals are, say you want to make sure you have redundancy, you can do that in different regions on one cloud provider, or you want to make sure that you're backing up stuff and it's separate from whatever it may be. I promise you, you probably can achieve that on one cloud, right? So my rant aside, I'm going to get off of my soapbox. Companies are still implementing multi-cloud solutions. So we have to have compliance solutions that can help us gather data from multiple cloud providers in an efficient manner. Prior to ByteCheck, I worked as an auditor for several years, and I performed a number of multi-cloud manual audits. And I can tell you from experience, that is not fun. I really wish I knew about CloudQuery or had CloudQuery back then, or the creators of it had built it by then, because it would have automated and streamlined a lot of the things that I was looking for. Looks like we have a pretty good question here around, do we think auditors will accept the results from CloudQuery /OSQuery as a legit artifact for an audit? I think this is one of the other challenges with the compliance process, right? It's not just about collecting the information. It's then about what are your auditors going to trust and believe in when it comes time to prove it. I think we're getting there to where auditors are becoming more technical. But I think we won't really see a huge shift in that until companies start to really force and ask the tough questions during the audit procurement process. Ask about the technical capabilities. Ask if you'll accept CloudQuery and OSQuery results. for the audit, because they should. The information from Cloud Query and OS Query, if I run a query on across my fleet of Windows machines and I'm checking the BitLocker settings, and I can run this a quick OS query on that, I'd much rather get that information as an auditor than a screenshot. The screenshot doesn't tell me much, but I can see that this is something that's running on a regular basis. Here's where the results are stored. And I can take a lot of those Excel or CSV files and interact with them in a programmatic manner. So I think, Adam, to answer your question, I think some auditors will. I think you'll have to, it's really dependent on the auditor that you're using and their technical capabilities to understand the evidence. But I think we should be making decisions more so based off of what's going to help our people get through and get this information. Because at the end of the day, yes, compliance is all about getting the report, right? We need to get the report. We need to get it out there to build sales. But more importantly, compliance should be used to help drive management decisions, should help the enterprise and the leaders in the company make better decisions about the security of their environment. So I think by using technical information such as OS Query and Cloud Query, we do that. We're going to talk about policy packs in a little bit, which are really great ways for you to automate and schedule some compliance checks. So one of those policy packs is a AWS CIS benchmark check. So it's going to literally go through the AWS CIS benchmarks and let you know whether or not that environment is passing or failing. So I think some of that takes education for the auditors, right? They have to understand how does this work, completeness and accuracy, and doing all of those tests. But once they understand it and they see the information it's producing, I really think it's going to result in better audits. One of the reasons why I'm so passionate about automating evidence in compliance audits is because I think it means we have technically accurate audits, which I don't think we can say today for most assessments. Oftentimes, the report that we get depicts a far different picture than what we are seeing in reality. In part one and part two, we really dove into the dangers of relying on evidence that only tells a portion of the story. And we use patch management as an example, where you can see some data at a high level, at an enterprise level, like, yeah, patch management looks great. But when you dig into the details and you look at the tactical information, that's where things start to get really bad. And that's why I think from a compliance perspective, we have to get away from saying, what's the evidence that's needed just to pass the audit or for the auditors? But how do we help our company become a more secure organization? If you think about compliance, if you just think about what a control is, it's just a risk mitigating activity, right? So we're going out and validating, do you have these risk mitigating activities in place? And management should be making decisions off of that, not necessarily the SOC 2 or whatever other report that's out there. And I think by using Cloud Query and OS Query, especially Cloud Query in the cloud, you're going to be able to produce information that, yes, it's going to get you through the audit. You're going to be able to prove compliance to your auditors and to your customers, but you're going to be able to get information to internal and really external parties that shows that your report is stronger. Your compliance report's actually going to mean more. The people that are going through it are actually going to care more about the results because they're going to understand there's a lot of really good information in there that is telling you accurate data about your environment. Really great question. I appreciate that. So the last thing I want to talk about here is Cloud Query Hub, which is a relatively new tool. And instead of sitting here and looking at it in the slide, especially because I don't think we're gonna be able to do a demo here, I'm just going to go to their site. There it is, hub.cloudquery.io, to do a quick, just to show you some of the things that are here. So first things first, let's look at all these different cloud providers, right? You have AWS, you have Azure, you have GCP. I mentioned the Kubernetes and the Okta providers as well. But let's just dive into the AWS ones because I want to show you, one, we can take a look at some of these query examples down here. This is what we were going to do. We're going to do some of these queries in the demo, but unfortunately, it's not working for me. But you're going to be able to do things like find all public-facing load balancers, find all unencrypted RDS instances, find all unencrypted buckets as well, which I think this should have been from AWS S3 buckets or unencrypted RDS clusters is what that should have said. But nonetheless, you can see really the basic structure of these statements. Most Cloud Query and OS Query SQL statements, really 99% of them are going to be a select. It's going to say, go get this information from a table. And we'll take a look at some of these tables here in a second. And then you can add some additional things like where clauses and other things to really accelerate and dive deep into the information that you need. Now imagine that you have a 10 account environment, 10 different AWS accounts, and you need to find out if there's all the unencrypted RDS instances across those 10 accounts. Doing that manually would not be a fun exercise. Running this one line across all 10 accounts, that is a way to automate compliance and make things really easy for yourself. Now, one thing I do want to show you here is the schema of these tables, because this is where you're going to be able to really get into some cool things when it comes to getting information. So as I mentioned earlier, this AWS IAM users table, it contains a ton of information, but maybe I just want to know the account ID, the username, and whether or not MFA is active. So that same select statement that we did, you can just say select the account ID, select MFA active, and select the username from this table. And that's only the information that it will return, which is really powerful, because instead of getting all of these results, you can really drill down into some specifics. So I know the first time that I really dove into OS Query and I saw all of the tables, my curiosity just kind of went crazy. And I was just thinking through all the different things that I could do. One of the first things I realized is that there's information in certain tables that I wish were in other tables. And one cool thing about SQL that you can do is you can join tables together. So if you know there's something in this EC2 flow logs table that you also want some information around security groups as well with the same VPC, you can join tables together and get really custom results. So I encourage you, if you're hosted on any of these cloud providers, which I'm sure most of you are at least hosted on one or two of them, poke around on Cloud Query Hub, because you're gonna be able to see the schema of the tables, which is gonna tell you exactly how this table was created, what are all the columns included, and you can start to see some of the information that you'll get out of there. Let me show you the S3 bucket table really quick, because that one's another one that we were gonna explore that has some really valuable information. You can't really read about AWS or explore AWS without hearing about an S3 bucket breach, right? And generally that's because a bucket is left publicly open. It's generally not encrypted. And you can check that directly here on Cloud Query. So you can check the public access, public ACLs, and whether or not they have some of these public policies in place on that particular bucket. You can also check if they have MFA delete in place, if there's login enabled. So a lot of the very important information you'll need, especially from a compliance perspective, you're gonna be able to get out of these tables. Now, the other thing I did wanna show as well is around policies. So like I mentioned, Cloud Query has put together some of these policies, Cloud Query policies, but you can put these together yourself. And if you click this, you're going to be able to, and I click into here, you can see the link here. You can dive into their GitHub to see all the details. But this one command right here is going to run the AWS CIS benchmark against your cloud environment. And that's really, really cool, you know, because you can get all of these different checks. So CIS 1.1, avoid the use of the root. You're gonna get into no root account access keys, all of the password stuff, CloudTrail things, all of these things that you would care about. I don't care which framework you're trying to address, you're gonna be able to get some valuable information. So let's actually take a look at one of these queries. Since I can't do a demo, this would be a good thing to show you here just to explain how some of this stuff works. So as you can see here, this query for AWS CIS 1.2 is going to ensure MFA is enabled for all of the users that have a password. So this query, you know, they're going to limit the results a little bit, right? I showed you that this table right here, this IAM users table, it has 20 columns. I don't need all information from all 20 columns. Maybe I just want this account ID. I just want the password last used. I just want the username, and I just want to know if MFA is active, right? Because I need to see some of this other information to know what's good or bad. So you're going to run this select these columns from this table. And then this where clause, this is where I can get really, really granular and specific. And I'm going out and saying, only give me results if the password's enabled and MFA active is not enabled. This, you're getting a false result from this MFA active column. So this is going to just give you back any of those users where MFA is not active. And that's going to tell you whether or not this CIS benchmark is failing. But again, they put this all in a policy pack. So instead of running these, I think it's, 20 or 30 of these queries, you don't have to do that. You can run that one line and perform a CIS benchmark test against your environment. Now, there's a bunch of open source tools out there that probably do, that I know for a fact do similar things, like Prowler, Electric Eye is a really good one. There's another one that just slips my mind right now. I think it starts with a D. If anyone out there knows it, drop it in the chat. There are some open source tools that do these things. What I would say is that getting the information you want, whether it's the CIS benchmarks or other information, especially if you want some unique information, it's a lot easier to do with Cloud Query because of this part right here. Because I can say specifically what information I want, specifically from a table. And then I can do some things here where I'm getting information that may be hard to get in another context. So we'll take a look at one more really quick before we finish up and see if there's any more questions. Where this where clause, there's a lot of things you can do with it. It can do where clauses based off of integers, based off of null results, text like you saw. You can also limit your results. There's a number of things you can do. And that's the cool thing about Cloud Query and OS Query using SQL is that you can really use the full power of that SQL database and that SQL engine to automate and get some detailed results. So despite not being able to perform the demo, because as I'm looking over at my virtual machine, it's definitely not going to work today because Murphy always comes to play when you want to do a live demo. But I hope that this Cloud Query Hub page is something that you all would bookmark and go out and visit and explore. So, if you're on the Azure side, same kind of concepts. Look at all these tables that you can get valuable information from about your Azure environment, similar GCP. So this isn't just about AWS, this is truly multi-cloud. So when you're really building out, how do I prove things? How do I maintain security from a compliance perspective across all of these different providers? And as you get into authentication and containers as well, Cloud Query is an option for you. It's a way that you can automate these checks, pull in this information on a regular basis so you can run Cloud Query policies on a schedule. And you make your life easier as a compliance professional, but ultimately your company's life easier as well. So that concludes the talk for today. I'm going to definitely hang around and chat, and I'll send over to Lara here in the next few days a recording of the demo that I was planning on doing so that you can see Cloud Query in action and see how some of these queries work. Also walk you through some of the basic syntax for SQL. But if you're looking for a really brief introduction to how to write some of these statements from a compliance perspective, take a look at part two of the webinar, the demo. We spent about 40 minutes, I believe, in a demo on that webinar going through how to use OS Query. And a lot of those concepts apply to Cloud Query. So if you're like, man, this sounds amazing, AJ, I'm trying to go try this out right now. Go out and watch that OS Query webcast really quick, see how to maneuver and use some of those commands, maybe have it on pause there as you're getting Cloud Query up and running, and then have some fun, look and explore those tables, look and explore some of the things that you can do with Cloud Query and figure out, is there a way that you can write some policies together of all the different checks that you have to do this in an automated manner? I really appreciate everyone that took time out of their day to join us. I don't take it lightly that you all have other things to do, but you decided to watch me fumble around here and struggle to get my VM working while hopefully educating you on a tool that I think is pretty cool. We're going to do some cool demos with it in Sec 557. That's the thing I love about Sec 557. About 50% of the 3-day course is demos, where we're doing labs and we're getting our hands dirty. And that's really the way that I learn. And I think it's a great way to learn as well. So I look forward to seeing some of you all in that course as well. And thanks, Laura, of course, always for all your help and getting things going and definitely holding it down at the beginning of the webinar.
Terrific. Sorry, I was on mute. AJ, thank you so much for your time today and your expertise as always. Once you get that demo over to me, I will get that uploaded and all of the registrants for the webcast will be given the link to see that demo. If anyone has any questions for AJ, you can ask them here. And otherwise, you can be on the lookout for the follow-up blog on this and we will see you next time. Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks, everyone.